Welcome to Worship at Bluegrass.
We're excited that you've chosen to spend this time with us today. Whether in person at our main campus or at any of our Bluegrass locations, we hope you find today's service to be uplifting and encouraging. But most of all, we hope you feel welcomed. If you ever have questions about Bluegrass, please visit us online at bluegrassunc.org. Again, thank you for joining us today. Now let's begin.
Happy Easter!
We are so excited you joined us today, not only in our main campus here, but whatever location you're joining us this morning.
We appreciate the fact that you're here to celebrate the risen Lord Jesus Christ.
So let's stand together and begin this time of praise singing.
The Apostles' Creed. Let's read together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth.
I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord,
who was conceived by the Holy Spirit,
born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried.
He descended to the dead, on the third day he rose again.
He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of God the Father.
And he will come again to judge the living and the dead.
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the universal church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Amen. Let's continue singing.
Thank you. As we go into a time of prayer together today, I'd like to remind you that we always love to pray with you and for you. So whether you're here with us at the main campus or joining us online, if you ever have a prayer request you'd like to send our way, you can always send those to office at bewilderment.org, and we would love to pray with you. That being said, let's pray together now.
Lord God, we are here to celebrate you.
We are here to celebrate the risen Lord Jesus Christ, the Lord of life, the author of salvation, the one who has overcome sin and death, who has declared victory and pours that victory out
in our lives, in the lives of the redeemed in Jesus the Christ, and those who claim this gift of salvation from the God of all creation, that we might enjoy eternal life in your presence and draw near to you.
So today, Lord God, come and be praised and celebrated among your people.
Come receive the worship that you alone are due.
Keep our eyes fixed on you, Lord God.
As creation declares your glory, your victory, your life. Let us hold fast to you. Let us come to you with what we have to give and lay at your feet. And receive the gift of eternal life found in you and you alone. Lord God, you are amazing, and we are yours. Come and receive the worship that you alone are due, because you alone are God. Please join me in praying the prayer Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Arise, my soul, remember. Thanks to our Hands of Harmony for their musical gifts and for them sharing the word with us this evening. Christ the Lord is risen. He is risen indeed. Amen. So welcome to worship on this Easter weekend. What a great weekend it is to gather together and to celebrate. This is our championship weekend, right? As Christians, this is our championship weekend. And it's so good to see so many of your faces and so many of your names for those of you who are watching online. So what a great weekend to come together and worship in the name of Jesus Christ, our risen Lord. Well, can I be honest with you? You probably say, well, Pastor, I hope you're honest with us every week, right? Well, I picked all Big Ten teams to be in the Final Four. All Big Ten teams. Can you believe that? Not one of them made it. You know what's really sad about that, being an IU Hoosier fan? That just shows you how bad the Hoosiers really are, right? I mean, we don't have any of the Big Ten teams in the Final Four. The Hoosiers didn't even make the tournament at all, and that tells you just how bad they are. Things are maybe looking up, and I'm becoming a fan of the IU women's basketball team, though, right? So they made the Elite Eight, and I don't know if you know this or not, but their coach is from Seymour, like I am. So that tells you something, right? That tells you something. I think she should coach the boys, the men's team, right? I think we would have a chance if that were the case. Well, let me be honest about something else then. Of the four Gospels retelling of the resurrection, the one we're going to look at tonight is my least favorite version. I didn't say I didn't like it. I just think of the four, it's my least favorite. Now, if you're a guest or if this is the first time you've been worshiping with us for a while, you need to know that we've been reading through the Gospel of Mark since the beginning of the year. And so we're finishing up the Gospel of Mark today. And it would be rather strange if I would change away from the Gospel of Mark to tell about the resurrection story. And so we're going to use the Gospel of Mark to tell us that. But the problem is, as we will see in a moment, it doesn't end exactly the way I want it to. Jesus still resurrects, so don't worry about that, okay? We've got that down. It's good. But we'll see. You see, I prefer the Hallmark movie ending of stories, right? Everything turns out predictably wonderful because, well, everyone has found true love, right? I mean, you leave the movie feeling so good about the characters and about everything that's going on. In fact, you just feel good about yourself. You feel good about the world in which we live. You're in your own little Shangri-La, right? At least that's what Jody tells me about Hallmark movies. I wouldn't know for myself, right? I've never watched a Hallmark movie. Now, that may not be so honest there, right? So, let's read the story. It's in Mark chapter 16, verses 1 to 8. When the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James and Salome, bought spices so that they might go to anoint Jesus' body. Very early on the first day of the week, just after sunrise, they were on their way to the tomb, and they asked each other, "Who will roll the stone away from the entrance of the tomb?" But when they looked up, they saw that the stone, which was very large, had been rolled away. As they entered the tomb, they saw a young man dressed in a white robe sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. "Don't be alarmed," he said. "You're looking for Jesus the Nazarene who was crucified. He has risen. He is not here. See the place where they laid him. But go tell his disciples and Peter, he is going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him just as he told you." Trembling and bewildered, the women went out and fled from the tomb. They said nothing to anyone because they were afraid. To kind of get a sense of why I say this is my least favorite, there with that ending in verse 8. But as that first resurrection day began to unfold, you know, the cast experienced it as it was happening, right? I mean, they didn't have the joyous celebration that we have today with our music and our message and with our flowers and with everything. We know the rest of the story. They did not. What we find to be amazingly wonderful is how the women followers of Jesus rose to center stage despite that patriarchal culture and the fact that there was absolutely no sign in the Gospel of Mark that Jesus even had any women followers until the crucifixion. It was at that critical time that they surfaced as the prime witnesses to the most holy events of our Christian faith. They viewed the crucifixion from a distance. They watched where Jesus was laid, and they were the first to hear the news of the resurrection. You know, what's remarkable that in the Gospel of Mark, none of Jesus' male disciples are mentioned at any of those places. But the women are. And Jesus broke the barrier for women to be included and equal in the Christian faith 2 millennia ago. That's old news. Well, the morning was dark as they began to make their way. But that rising sun soon dispelled the darkness. The dawning light not only marked a new day, but a new era, a new beginning for all of history, for all of humanity. Hope, hope was on the horizon. The psalmist said it this way: "Weeping may last for a night. Oh, but rejoicing comes in the morning." And they would soon find that out. So we need to know the women were not expecting a miracle that first Easter morning because Easter wasn't on their calendar yet, right? In fact, they were so grief-stricken that they didn't even know how they were going to roll the stone away. They hadn't made plans. They'd made all other kind of plans, but they didn't make any plans to move that large stone away. I mean, even a circular stone would be difficult because it would have to be rolled uphill, up an incline, or lifted out of a groove, and that wasn't going to be easy to do. But Scripture says, as they lifted their heads, they were lifting their heads out of the downward dejection of defeat, they saw the impossible had happened. The large stone, Mark wants to tell us it's a large stone, a very large stone, had been moved, had been rolled away. The first sign of hope they had that morning was when they looked up. Friends, if we want to experience the hope of the resurrection, we must learn to look up. Not down, not around, but up. Again, the psalmist said it this way in Psalm 121. "I lift up my eyes to the mountains. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth." Friends, where are you looking today? Are you looking down into the darkness of your circumstances? Are you looking around at what others have and what you don't have? Are you going to look to the only one who gives you real help and real hope? The one who created heaven and earth. the one who has come to resurrect your life and offer you a fresh start. Look up to him. That's where it begins. So in Mark's brevity of writing style, his is the shortest of the four Gospels. He doesn't bother to tell us how the stone was moved. He assumes that his readers, his listeners to his gospel were smart people and would know a miracle had occurred. He just wants us to know that the tomb was open so that the women could enter in and see that Jesus wasn't there. But surprise, 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 it wasn't empty. An angel was inside and gave that common angelic message, don't be afraid. It's easy for you to say, angel, I'm afraid right now. I'm not used to seeing angels. But if there was any doubt that they were at the right tomb, the angel confirmed, see the place where they laid him. And if there was any doubt that they had the right person, the angel identified him as Jesus the Nazarene, whom they crucified. He is risen. He is now risen. Take a look for yourself. He isn't here. He is resurrected. I've been inside a couple of those cave graves in Jerusalem, and you have to enter into an opening. You kind of have to duck down, and then you go inside, and depending upon the size of the cave grave, you might have to stay bent. Or some of them are larger, and you can kind of stand up a bit. The point is, it wouldn't take long to look around to see Jesus' body wasn't there. But that presents another issue. Okay, Jesus' body isn't here, but what happened to his body? That's why the angel was there. That's why the angel was there to declare that Jesus had resurrected. That was an outlandish claim, right? It still is. That's why through all these centuries, that there have been folks who have declared different things about this story, right? Jesus didn't resurrect. His body was stolen. Or the women went to the wrong tomb. Or Jesus really didn't die on the cross. It only appeared he had. They put him in the tomb. He renewed back to life and he walked out of the tomb. However, after he had been so badly beaten and crucified, how did he roll the stone away, right? And why would the disciples, why would they put their lives on the line if they knew that Jesus had died and really had not risen and it was all a sham? If he not had bodily resurrected, why would they have gone to their own deaths? Which most of them did. The only thing that makes sense to me, maybe there's another answer, but is they believed the news of resurrection and they had seen Jesus. Well, the angel had more to say. He told the women, hey, go tell the disciples and Peter. Jesus is going ahead of you, and he's going to meet you in Galilee, just as he told you before. Don't you love the fact that the angel singled out Peter? We know Peter had suffered major failure just a couple of days before when he had denied his Lord, not once, not twice, but three times, denied his friend, his Savior. And he was hit with tremendous remorse and guilt. If you've ever felt such pain, if you've denied the Lord, or if you've betrayed a friend, you know the pain of Peter, right? You know that deep remorse if you've ever been in his shoes. But God's grace was shining through that morning. God's grace shone through the angel to the women. It's going to be passed on to the disciples. Jesus wants to meet with you. Jesus wants to meet with you. You know, when Jesus had predicted Peter's failure at the Last Supper, he told them, you know, after I die, resurrect, I'm going to meet you back in Galilee. So he'd already warned them about that, or not really warned them, forewarned, foretold them. But why Galilee? Why go back to Galilee? Well, it was where they basically were all from. Jesus was from there. It's where the ministry had started. It's where they entered in and saw Jesus' compassion, his love for people. They heard him teach. They saw him perform miracle after miracle there. And by going back to Galilee, the disciples went back to where they were first called and where they'd once again be commissioned into the world as the witnesses of the resurrection. They were going back home to a certain degree so they could start again, start afresh. Even going back to the same lake, the Sea of Galilee, a large lake, where Jesus had called Peter and Andrew, James and John to leave their fishing business behind, and they did. And it would be at that same lake where Jesus would forgive Peter and recommission him, recommission them. Even though Peter had failed, he would discover he wasn't forsaken. Even though he was flawed, he wasn't forgotten. Instead, he was forgiven and welcomed back into the fellowship of the disciples. This is the forgiving grace of the gospel. This is the forgiving grace that the resurrection confirms. This is the forgiving grace that is the hope for our future, that the resurrection brings to every one of us who believe it and receive it and own it for ourselves. Now, I don't have any problems with what we've heard so far with this resurrection story. It's all been good, right? It's this next verse that trips me up and many others as well. In fact, in your Bible, if you open your Bible, you say, well, Pastor, there's more than 8 verses. But usually it will tell you in your Bible, verses 9 and following, these verses are not included in the earliest manuscripts of Mark. So it's believed by many that they were added later because Mark's ending, his resurrection story, was so short. Now, listen, there's nothing wrong with these added verses. They speak truth. They have the same, authority coming from other gospels. I mean, they match up with the other gospels telling. So the problem isn't the content. It's just when they were placed there, right? So if it's true that Mark really did end at verse 8, and then some others came along later and wanted to give a little more detail than Mark, why did he do that? Thankfully, we do have the other Gospels that give us the details that Mary went on and found the disciples and told them what the angel had said, that she had seen the risen Lord. A couple of the disciples went to the tomb to check it out for themselves. They wanted to see for themselves if Jesus was truly gone from the tomb. And then Jesus appeared to the women, and Jesus appeared to the disciples later that night. But in Mark, we're left with the women leaving bewildered, not saying anything to anyone because they're afraid. Well, we can understand that, right? That was a startling morning. They were expecting to find the body of Jesus there, and he wasn't there. So what do we do with this? Scholars have debated that for centuries. So first of all, let's remember Mark is the shortest of the Gospels, and it's not surprising that he is the shortest account of the resurrection. He is a man of relatively few words. And in many stories that he is told, he does the same thing. He just expects us to already know it, or he just doesn't think that those details at that moment are that important. And so we also must remember that they were experiencing the resurrection one step at a time. They didn't have the full picture. They didn't have the full knowledge that we do. One commentator said this: though the resurrection happened suddenly, Easter itself is a slow-rising reality. It's one thing to believe that the tomb is empty, yet quite another to believe that Jesus is risen from the dead. And so they were frightened and confused, which kept them silent at first, sure, right? They were scared. I think Mark wants to put us into that morning, to feel it, to feel the full impact of that morning and what it felt like. That there was fear and there was bewilderment and there was just a lot of up in the air, not knowing what was happening. So as the other Gospels tell us, they went searching for the disciples. It's likely then that they didn't say anything to anyone. No, they didn't tell anyone. Until they got to the disciples, then I imagine they did a lot of talking then, right? And as other people would read this Gospel, they would have heard the full story of resurrection as well. So again, Mark assumes a lot of knowledge on our behalf. And he chose to emphasize the mystery and the glory of resurrection. This event is the climax of all of God's saving acts. It confirms that the crucifixion is the one final and great sacrifice so that we can gain victory over our fiercest enemies of sin and death. The very things that we hate the most about this world. Christ won, defeated, won the championship. You know, if we're honest, speaking about honesty, Mark's uncomfortable ending may actually connect where we spend much of our lives, right? I mean, do we ever wonder what's going on in our world? This last year, did we ever wonder what in the world is going on in our world with this pandemic? With countries threatening one another, at war with one another, with mass shootings on the rise again, with prejudice and injustice showing its demonic self over and over again? Haven't we learned? When will we learn? And then there are all the personal encounters that we experience with illness, tragedy, and death. This world isn't fair. It's not just. Why? Because it's badly broken. It needs a lot of help. It needs a lot of Jesus. It needs to be redeemed. There needs to be resurrection to new life. And that's why the resurrection demands that the dynamic message of the gospel must be proclaimed. Yes, the women must go to the disciples. The disciples must go to Galilee, where they'll be recommissioned, sent into the world to tell the world so that we can know today that Jesus Christ resurrected. And so the resurrection sets into motion a new story that is not finished. It won't be completed until all true believers are gathered together on that final day in history. And so what happens next, though, is up to us in this story. We must choose to enter into the story, for we are the next chapter. We must make the decision, what are we going to do with the news that Jesus is not there, that he has resurrected? Will we believe it or not? Will we leave our worship time? Will we go to Easter dinner? Will we have an egg hunt and then just continue on with life as usual? Or do we truly believe this story? Has it grabbed a hold of us? Will we go where Jesus is going because he is going ahead of us? He's leading the way to a new place, to a new home, to a new kingdom, to a glorious and beautiful, pain-free new heaven and new earth that is coming one day. Like the women, we might be a bit bewildered and confused today, even afraid of what's going on in and around us in our own world. But in the midst of that, will we choose faith? Will we choose to believe that the resurrection is truth? That the tomb is empty? That Jesus is alive? That the resurrection matters? That it is the bedrock of our faith? That it is our hope for tomorrow? It is our ticket to eternity of perfect peace and joy. The Apostle Paul tells us how to retain that ticket in Romans 10, 9 to 10. If you declare with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For it is with your heart that you believe and are justified, and it is with your mouth that you profess your faith and are saved. This is where we must begin today, if we're not already there today. This is what we must declare today. that Jesus is the Lord of life, that Jesus is Lord over death. There is nothing greater than the resurrection power of Christ. It has defeated death. And there is hope for us, for the future, for all of our loved ones who have believed in Christ Jesus, that we will see them again. If our hope, if our faith is in Jesus Christ, our Lord, we need to believe it, we need to live it, and we need to declare it. And I want you to declare it if you truly believe it in your heart. If you believe truly in your heart that Jesus Christ in bodily form resurrected from the dead, then Paul says we can declare Jesus is Lord. For those who believe, would you declare it with me? Jesus is Lord. One more time. Jesus is Lord. How about one more time? Jesus is Lord. Amen. He is.
Out of
Do you believe it? Do you believe it? Amen. Amen. We do believe it. And I trust that we're going to keep on believing it, keep on living it. That's the challenge, is to live it, right? To believe it and live it in the midst of the circumstances of life. But that we'll leave here with that hope and with that power of resurrection breathing within our souls, empowering us to go out and to rise above the circumstances of life. Because where does our help come from? It comes from there, right? From the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. So let's keep looking up, keep believing and trusting. God bless you. Thank you so much for worshiping with us this weekend. And we look forward to seeing you next weekend at 8:30 or 9:45. Have a blessed weekend. I love you. Happy Easter. Amen.